Are you ready for your MCAT? As a pre-med student, you have slaved over your MCAT material for months. You've sacrificed family, friends, a social life, all just to prepare for this exam. But now with a few weeks to go, you might be starting to wonder, did I do everything that I had to do? And am I ready for this exam? The better question is, should you wait until you're ready? Many students will never feel ready for this exam. And many students who've tested and actually done well will tell you that they did not feel ready for their exam. But you're not aiming for a 528. You're not aiming for a perfect score. So it's okay if you're not 100% ready. In that case, where do you draw the line? Do you just wing it? Do you go into this hoping that you're going to do your best because you said, I'm going to test on this date, and when the date rolls around, test no matter what? Don't get me wrong. Hope and prayer have their place, but I like a data-driven approach. I like to see numbers that justify being prepared to test. What do the numbers tell you? There are two sets of numbers you're going to look at: content and practice scores. Let's start with content. In the article linked below, I talk about the three phases of MCAT prep, where phase one is content. It's the most tedious, it takes the most amount of time, but that's only your foundation. You have to get through all of content before you even think about being ready for this exam. Now, I know this sounds silly, but you'll be amazed at how many emails I get from students saying, Leia, I'm about to test and I haven't finished all of biochemistry yet. You're about to test and you haven't finished content? That's not good. So how do you measure content? Everyone's approach to content is different. Maybe you just want to go through a set of books. Maybe you have two sets of books and videos and whatever other craziness. Simplify it, then set your content to 100%. If you have 5 books at 100% and you have done 8 out of 10 chapters in every book, that's 80%. Once you hit 100%, maybe you don't know everything perfectly, but at least you know you've gotten through content. Don't worry, you'll fill in the gaps when you do your practice exam review. Which brings us to the second number, full-length practice MCATs. These are simulated exams taken under realistic conditions as if it's the real thing to see how you do on test day if today was test day. When you're evaluating your practice test, please be honest with yourself, because this is where so many students talk themselves into something unrealistic and then have regrets later on. It's better to decide now that you're not ready and postpone the exam than risk having a low score on your permanent record and still being forced to take the exam again. Say you're just a few weeks out. How many full lengths should you take? There's no real answer to this question, except that there's such a thing as too few and there is such a thing as too many. The average successful student takes anywhere from 7 to 10 full lengths. If you take 6, you could be fine. If you take 12, you could be fine as well. But make sure it makes sense. Make sure you take your full lengths with a purpose. Many students email me after they get their scores back and they're unhappy with the results. And I can't tell you how surprised I am over and over when I ask them how they scored in the full lengths prior. And they'll say, well, I only took the one, but it was over a few days. That's not good. You have to take a couple of full-length exams simulating test date conditions to get an idea of the exam itself, but also how you would do in those conditions. On the other hand, I've heard from students who have taken exam after exam after exam, and their scores aren't going up. One student in particular emailed me that he took 15 full lengths over 2 months and hardly saw an increase in score. They kept jumping between 492 and 497. But he took so many exams, what was he doing wrong? It's not just about the full length, it's about what you do before and after. This student, by taking so many exams, was simply paying lip service to the process. Took the exam, now what? No. You have to review each exam, you have to learn from the exam, and you have to find a way to increase your score from test to test, which is exactly the purpose. When you plan this out, you want your scores to go something like this. Now, in reality, they're going to go something like that with a general upwards trend. That's what we're looking for. That's the improvement. Take enough exams to be comfortable and familiar with the process. Space them out so that you can get something out of the exams. Maybe every 4 to 6 weeks in phase one, about 2 a month in phase two, and weekly in phase three, ideally the AMC exams, because hey, if they write your test and they write the practice test, this will be the closest to the real thing. And now that you're a few weeks out and you are confident with these exams and you have taken quite a few, ask yourself this. How did I score on the last three full-length exams? Was there consistency, and how does this compare to my target? If your goal is a 512 and you have 3 weeks to go, you look at your last three exams and you've scored a 499, a 502, and a 504. I don't think you're ready. Even though it's just a few points and you promise to study really hard over the next few weeks, fact of the matter is, if you haven't yet hit that score, what makes you think you'll jump even more on test day? But don't just take my word for it. Look at the trend for the average increase. If in the last three full lengths you increased about 2 points per exam and you stopped at a 504, and now you're hoping to increase another 6 or 8 points in 3 weeks, you're expecting more of yourself at the end than you've done before without having proven to yourself that you can do it. Now take another student aiming for a 512, but their practice scores are a 506, a 511, and then a 509. Now we get into murky waters. With 3 weeks to go, you're so close to your target score. Chances are you could hit that score, but it's not a guarantee. If you find yourself in a position where you're very close, ask yourself this question. If for some reason I come out of this exam with a 508, am I okay with that? Picture yourself a month from now. You log in, you look at your MCAT score, and it's a 508. What do you do? Do you say, you know what, this is good enough, let me submit my application? Or do you say, this is no good, I have to test again? If you know that you're going to test again with that number, don't even test. Don't put yourself through this if you know it's not going to bring you where you need to be. And if you're going to test again anyway, you're better off either voiding your exam or postponing it and taking it later. Now let's look at a third scenario. If you find yourself in a position where with a few weeks to go, you're just a few points shy of your exam, this is where you make the hard decision. If you're within 3 to 5 points of your exam and a few weeks to go, chances are you could still bring up that score, but chances are you might not hit it all the way. This is why I recommend that in practice, you aim for a buffer of 2 more points, meaning a 512 target score would mean a 514 in practice. This way, if you panic on test day and you lose a few points, you're still on track, you're still good to go. Taking all of that into account, what are you looking for? A general upward trend, consistency in your scores, and very close to your target. If you hit your target just once and never again, you don't know if it means you're capable of that score or if it was a fluke. You're better off knowing before you commit, because this is that next step that you've been working so hard for and you don't want to risk it. If you're not quite ready to test because you're still figuring things out, but you're overwhelmed by all the contradictory information online, I have something for you. My ultimate guide to MCAT prep will walk you through everything you need to know to prepare for this exam. From what the exam is all about, how to choose a target score, which subjects to take, into the specifics, how to work on the individual sections, taking practice exams, and so much more. You can also download the companion workbook so you can take notes and follow along, making sure that you have a strategic approach rather than just doing everything you hear, hoping for the best, and then being surprised on test day. You can find the guide by visiting MCATstrategyguide.com. That's also where you can download the free companion workbook. That's MCATstrategyguide.com.